this is the start of something new. We want to do something. It's going to be all kinds of different stuff we're going to do on Sunday evenings. For this night, I'm going to do something a little different. I'm going to do about 10 minutes of talking, and then we're going to do some Q&A, some opportunity for you to ask questions. And maybe you're going to ask questions about stuff that I'm going to talk about for the next few minutes. Or maybe it's stuff that you're just wondering about, theologically, culturally, whatever you're going through, whatever. We're going to have an opportunity. Morgan May is going to come out, or Morgan Truel. We're all getting used to calling her Morgan Truel. Give it up for Morgan getting married a few weeks ago. Amazing. And we're going to hang out and do a little Q&A. So what I need you to do is start texting in your questions right now. Questions to 56316. That's what we're going to do. I'm going to talk for about 10 minutes here and just set the stage. And you can ask questions about stuff I'm talking about for the next few minutes. Or you can just ask things that you're like, hey, I'm just wondering about this. And we're going to try to hone in on things that you're really going through or wonder about. So I thought for my time, I would continue on with a few of the verses that I never got to, because I preached 2 verses this morning and I was assigned 11. So I'm just going to do a few minutes of reflection on these verses in Ephesians chapter 1, after verse 2 that I shared this morning. It says, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. I just love the word praise, because sometimes we just, it sounds like a real Christian-y word. It's like, oh, praise the Lord, or praise. It's like praise, if you think about what praise is in your life, it's something where you love something so much that you can't help but express it. And C.S. Lewis talks about the idea that until it's expressed, it's actually not even complete yet. Praise, it's like when you love somebody and you're really jacked about them and you start talking to your friends about them, or you read a book or you saw a movie and you loved it and you're excited about it, but it's almost, it's not complete until you tell somebody about it and go, you gotta meet this person. When Aaron and I started dating, I wanted to like have my friends meet her, but I didn't, we weren't like official yet, but I wanted to get like the evaluation of her. And so I called my buddy Matt. I'm like, hey, meet me in the back path. Aaron and I are going to be back there hanging out, just chatting, whatever, go for a walk. And you just like ride your bike through and just like, oh, Matt's here, right? And we were like 20 at the time, so I don't know why he's riding his bike still. But anyway, so Matt came riding back. Oh, this is Aaron. This is my friend Aaron. And he like walks away and he calls me later. He's like, dude, you gotta date her, man. She's hot. All right, so. But it's like you haven't, the joy in something, Lewis's point is, the joy in something isn't really complete until it's shared. That's what the word praise is. What we were just doing right now was vocally saying, man, I treasure God so much, I have to sing about it. I got to talk about it. I want to share it. And the question is, do you do that in the normal rhythm of life? That's what praise is. Praise isn't singing. It's sharing what you love about God with the world, and your joy in him isn't complete until you do it. And so Paul starts the letter off and goes, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. What God has done for you is your identity is rooted in the person and the work of Jesus in the heavenlies. And there's a power in the context of the world is not just what you see and feel and taste and touch in front of you. Scientific naturalism will tell us the only thing that exists is this stuff that you see, and you can put through a scientific method and you're supposed to believe in that. But the Bible comes along and goes, no, actually, there is a heavenly realm. And there are powers and principalities in the heavenly realm that impact our life. We know that. There are demonic things that tempt and influence. And this is why, I think I shared this a few weeks ago. This is why one of the preaching mentors that I had back up in Vancouver, he's a guy named Daryl Johnson. He's like 75 years old, an amazing pastor, amazing preacher. And someone asked him one time, if you showed up to church and nobody came, no one came to the 6 o'clock service, Mark, what would you be doing with this time? And without even missing a beat, he just said, I would still preach the sermon that I prepared, because the principalities and the powers in the room need to hear that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. That they have been defeated in the cross and the resurrection of Jesus, and he is the reigning, ruling king of all things. They need to be told this. They need to be reminded of this, because as a couple of those songs were talking about, do you know the only power you have is the name of Jesus? You don't have any power in you, no matter what New Age philosophy tells you. You have no power in you to actually save yourself. So Paul says in verse 4, in all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy. He's like, I find power when I pray. Now, I don't know what your prayer life's like, but I find it difficult. There's a book I'm reading right now called The Shallows, and it's a sociological book about the fact that you and I have such low attention spans. We have the lowest attention spans out of any generation ever, and that's going to be a problem for your prayer life, right? I mean, that's not what the book's about. The book's a sociological study about how we're all getting dumber, but I'm applying it to a prayer life, because what he says, even the writer, he did a PhD, he had to sit in a library for years and study and read footnotes, and even he says, man, when I start to read a book, I find myself distracted so fast, quicker than I was 20 years ago, because my brain is constantly just taking in useless information from the internet, and now I'm just distracted. Like some of you right now, like, you don't even know what I said 3 minutes ago, right? And this is what happens. Our brains aren't. And so when we pray, we kind of try to focus. And we're like, Lord, I just pray for Judy. And I got to get that homework done. What was that homework assignment supposed to be? Right? That's what. I got to shop for that stuff next weekend. And your life gets distracted. So here's a little quick tip. For those of you who are like, I don't know what to pray. Especially young people. That are like, what I did when I was first a Christian, because I didn't know how to pray. There's a couple things you can do. The first is read the Psalms. That's the prayer book of the Bible. Secondly, pray the Lord's Prayer. And what I used to do is structure the Lord's Prayer, and then I kind of extrapolate on it as I went. And so I would say, you know, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And then I'd like spend a few minutes talking about that theme. Like, this is what I would love to see happen in this person's life, or, you know, this is what I would know. And you kind of extrapolate there. Or there was this acronym that I was given by my youth pastor, ACTS, ACTS. Basically what you do is you just acknowledge God. You don't just jump to this is what I need. You acknowledge who he is. You confess sin. Then you give him thanks. And then S, you start to give him supplication, meaning here's what I would love to see happen. But you don't just jump to that. You like, God, here's who you are. Thanks for what you've done. Here's the sin in my life. Oh, and I also pray for Jody and everything goes well, whatever. And so those are little tips for what was going on with me. So, and he says, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. He starts the book by saying, I want you to lift your eyes toward the end of all things. That sometimes we talk about the fact that Jesus came and he lived and he died and he rose, but there's another part of the gospel that sometimes we forget, which is that he's coming again, right? And Paul goes right from the beginning of Philippians, he goes, I want your eyes to be on the coming of Jesus, the day of Christ Jesus, where you will stand before God. Every single human will stand before God and he will evaluate our lives and go, what did you do with my son Jesus? See, we as a culture spend all our time going, hey, who are you? Who are you? Go inside, find yourself, your identity. Who are you? And the question on the day of Christ Jesus is going to be, who is Jesus to you? Not who are you? Who am I? Not me. This is Jesus talking. Who am I? Who was I to you? And God is going to say, what did you do with my son? That's going to be the question. And so he has his eye toward the end of all things. And we don't know when that's going to be. That could be tomorrow. Could be before the service ends. Could be another tens of thousands of years, a million years. We have no idea. But the point is, you live your life with your eye to the last day. when you are going to stand before Jesus and give an account for your life. You're going to give an account for your heart, not just your behavior, but your heart. And he says, that's all about the day of Christ. And then down in verse 9, he says, and this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight. It's fascinating to me, if you got a Bible, underline the word knowledge. It's fascinating to me that Christians have become the anti-knowledge people. We were the ones who started all the universities. We were the ones who have blazed the path in science, philosophy, psychology, history. And now we're seen as the people who would rather feel something than think. Which is why most of what we do is more sentimental than it is intellectually driven. And Paul goes, here's what I want you to go deep on. Your knowledge, your insight, your discernment, that the world would look at you as it's looked at Christians for the 15, when we started the universities, when we started the scientific method, when we wrote philosophy and we were known as the greatest philosophers, the greatest writers. Most of the great writing and art that has been done all through history were done by people who loved and treasured Jesus. Most of the great science that has been done. And now we're like, oh, we don't like those things. And so we're going to create kind of an enclave of stuff and do our own stuff. And we forget that Paul's going, the deeper you go in knowledge, the more you're going to find him. Don't be afraid of knowledge and insight and wisdom. All right, so those are the opening verses. Paul lays out these huge priorities, and the question becomes, how are we then going to follow Jesus in the teeth of the world? And that's what the book of Philippians is going to go on to be about. Okay, now we're going to segue to Morgan Truel coming out for Q&A. Do me a favor, as we make that segue, take 1 minute, stand up, and greet someone around you, say, good to see you, and then we'll jump into Q&A. Oh, wow.
Well, hey, guys, you ready for some questions?
All right, can everybody welcome Morgan to the stage? Woo, okay. Q&A, gotta love it. Sometimes it's just a monologue, and it's good to be like, what are people wrestling through? How can we speak to it? So we'll do the best we can.
We got a ton of questions.
We do,
Over
100 great.
Questions already.
100 so questions?
We're not gonna get to these all tonight, but we're gonna keep doing stuff like this. So if your question doesn't get answered tonight, no stress. We'll figure out another way to answer your question coming up soon. But we'll start with some Philippians questions, and then we'll go a little bit off topic if that works for you.
Great.
Okay, first things first, on the subject of joy, if I'm a Christian but I don't experience a lot of joy, am I missing something?
Yes, if we're defining joy as how we defined it this morning, which is like, it's not about necessarily feeling happy. Paul was in prison, and this same letter that is about joy is a letter where he's in prison getting beaten. Like, it's not like prison today where you can get an education and things are great. Like, it's not even sure he's going to get food and water. He's getting tortured. And yet he writes a book where 16 times he talks about joy, because it's not always connected to your feelings and it's not always connected to your circumstances. It's what one writer has called a serious joy, a joy with like weight, a joy that says like I can tell you as a pastor, I have gone to the bedside of people who are passing away. And I remember this one lady, she had 3 young kids. And she was passing away of cancer, and she just looked at me, and I said, are you scared? And she's like, I can just be dead honest with you. I'm not scared. And I have this unwavering joy that I'm about to experience something I've never, that everything in this life dulls the kind of delight and pleasure I'm about to go to. I am fearful about my kids, though. And I want to make sure they're taken care of. And in those moments, as a pastor, you're tempted to like, even as a young pastor, I'll take care of them. And it's like, don't say that. But it was like the teeth of the world, as I was saying earlier, like there was so much kind of, I want to make sure my kids are okay, fear. This disease is racking my body and I know I'm almost gone. But because my faith is in the transcendent, because my faith is in Jesus that transcends a circumstance, I can tell you the word joy is what I feel right now.
Wow.
Tim Keller, who just passed away recently, he was going through a cancer battle for about 4 years. And when he wrote about it right near the end of his life, he said, I know this sounds really cliche or crazy. I wouldn't trade this for the world. For the amount of intimacy that I have with Christ that nothing else in this world could have drawn out of me.
That's great.
So it's something that, so I would say, I want you to experience joy in the biblical sense of joy. Not necessarily, you don't have to always necessarily feel happy. But I want you to experience like true joy.
That's great. That's
a great
answer.
Does that make
sense? Yeah, that's awesome. Next question is this. Can you explain why Paul...
Probably not.
Huh?
Sorry.
Oh, this is my question. It's actually not my question. Can you explain why Paul was a public figure with a background of being a murderer of Christians, yet if you're a Christian today and you've made some pretty intense mistakes, you're usually qualified from being a public figure? Woof.
What?
Did that make sense?
Do it again. Do it again.
Can you explain why Paul...
Yes.
Was a public figure with a background of being a murderer of Christians. Yet, if you're a Christian and you've made some pretty intense mistakes in your life, you're disqualified from potentially being a public figure.
Disqualified. I thought you said that those things almost qualify you to be a Christian leader.
No.
I'm like, what? Too deep for me. This room is deep. Well, I mean, the reality about Paul and his murdering is he did it before he met Jesus, so that's one thing. So you can have lots of leaders who did a lot of things before they met Jesus. And then they are able to say, hey, look, this is what I did. I met Jesus. But that doesn't take away from the fact that Paul probably made a bunch of mistakes, too, whether they were disqualifying mistakes. I mean, the rest of the New Testament is pretty clear. If you're going to be in leadership, you should have some qualities about your character, not competencies, but character. That's why when Paul writes, like, hey, if you want to be an elder, whatever, he doesn't start with, make sure they're really good at this. He goes, make sure they're, you know, husband of one wife, or they're not greedy for gain, or, you know, he goes after the character. Because my friend Carrie Newhoff says, competencies can get you in the room, but character keeps you there. And so, so there is a higher expectation on Christian leaders because they are an example. So if someone's a pastor and a leader, and they have a completely messed up moral life, there is something to, hey, why don't you, you know, take a seat for a while or, you know, whatever until we can get, you know, things back. And you show us, I know many leaders that have been that. There is a route there. And then sometimes it's just like, okay, maybe you might never, you know, be in ministry again because people might not trust you.
Yeah.
So there is a quality, but Paul's past, the short answer is Paul's past was before he met Jesus, but that doesn't mean we can't make mistakes as leaders. It just means there are certain times that we'll do certain things that might disqualify us or at least take the bench for a while,
yeah.
Which is fair.
Yeah, it's great. In this passage today, we talked about the day of Christ.
Yeah.
Can you explain that?
Yeah, I mean, I talked about it a little bit here, but the day of Christ is a short form for Paul for the end of all things when Jesus comes back. We don't talk about it very often in church, and part of the reason is because there's been lots of churches that have really hammed it up and made it almost like a silly thing where they have maps up on their stage and they do, you know, series on it for 2 years and... on this event, and then Ronald Reagan, and then Iraq, and then Russia, you know. And everyone's like, I think the end is tomorrow. I think the end's tomorrow. And then it goes by. I mean, my wife grew up in a church that constantly believed it was like, it's right, it's soon. The rapture is going to happen. The rapture. The rapture is going to happen. You know, there's a book by Hal Lindsey, 88 Reasons Why the Rapture is going to Happen in 1988. And then that passed, and he updated it to 1989. And he just missed it by a couple months. And it's like, we've done all this projecting, and we've failed every time. So I think what happens is, as leaders, we don't want to play to that base of, like, I love talking about the end times all the time. It's like, yeah. But, like, most of your problems are still there in your life. And you don't, like, think about discipleship because you're trying to decode, you know, Revelation 13, verse 1, and what it means about the present newspaper and what happened yesterday with Jerusalem. And everyone gets all jacked. So I think churches tend to stay away from it. But in the Puritan version, it's that, there will be an end to all things. It's in Greek, it's the word telos, and it's why when you study teleology, it's the study of the where something is going, the end point, the goal for a thing. And the goal is that Jesus Christ is going to come back, and he's going to judge the living and the dead. And John 5 tells us everyone will be resurrected, and we will sit at the judgment seat of Christ, and the question will be asked, what did you do with Jesus? And if you trusted Jesus, you go to a resurrection of life, and if you didn't, you go to a resurrection of judgment. That's constantly the picture. So when Paul uses that phrase, the day of Christ, he's trying to say, it's anybody in this room can start something, a relationship with Jesus. Anybody in this room can start something, but the question is, do you get to the last day, not just the first day? What do you still treasure Jesus Christ on the last day of your life versus the first day of your life? So that's why he's got this completion day of Christ right in the opening verses. I want you to be thinking about your last day, or potentially when Jesus comes back, what are you doing? And then live your life backwards.
Yeah.
The book of Ecclesiastes says it's always better to go to a funeral than a wedding. Because when you go to a wedding, yours is fantastic. But when you go to a wedding, you're just partying and hanging out and dancing and having fun. But no one walked up to you in your wedding and say, so what do you think about the day of your death?
No one said that.
Because no one wants to talk about important things like the weight of my soul at a wedding. They just want to have fun. But at a funeral, people go, man, am I going to die soon? What am I doing with my life?
Yeah.
And that's why Paul puts it, hey, guys, have the day of Christ in front of you. Don't get wacky about it. Just live your life backwards from it.
It's good. This person asked, if we are citizens of heaven, how does this impact our American citizenship? And they even asked the question, should we not serve in the military because of this?
It's a great question. So it doesn't affect how it affects your American citizenship is a sense of just make sure you don't put your American politics and citizenship above the kingdom, like I talked about this morning, right? Like, the kingdom is made up of every tribe, tongue, and nation from the world. And so that's your priority. The question of military is a smart one because it connects it to the fact that there are times when potentially you might have to kill somebody who belongs to another country who's a Christian. That's the tension. So the guys who dropped the atomic bomb on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, later, one of the pilots regretted it because he was a Catholic and he realized that he'd killed more Catholic Japanese people than these were brothers and sisters in Christ. And doesn't my, isn't the spirit go above blood? And so he struggled with that. I wouldn't say I should probably answer directly the military question in the sense of I'm Canadian and we depend on your military to save us. So I appreciate it. Like if North Korea goes sideways, we're looking at you and saying, hey, help us out here. Well, yeah, we got canoes. We can help out. So I appreciate people in the military. The comment I'll make about it is theologically there are different views within Christianity on Christians in the military. So on the one side of the spectrum, it's just war, and it's why would I let other people, totalitarian people, kill and destroy widows and orphans and people who can't help themselves if I, by aggression, can go and lay down my life for my friends and help people? Why wouldn't I do that? On the other side of the spectrum, the Anabaptist, the pacifist side, it would be they would make a distinction based on Romans 12 talks about the idea that the government is allowed to use the sword to do justice, and they would just say that's fine for the government to do, but Christians shouldn't be in the government, and Christians shouldn't be part of the system of the sword. They should just allow the secular systems to do the sword, but it doesn't mean we have to be part of it. That would be the extreme Anabaptist side of it that would say, I'm not going to be a police officer, I'm not going to be in the military because I'm going to have to aggressively use force physically on someone, and Jesus told me I was supposed to turn the other cheek. So that's the extreme version of that, and those are the two poles that you can then do some reading and try to figure out where you land versus,
That's great. This person has, can we go off topic for a second?
Yes.
Off Philippians topic?
Yes.
Can you explain the mark of the beast?
Oh, wow. Okay. Of course I can.
Welcome to 6 p.m. service.
The 6. We're trying to brand this service, and we're calling it the 6. I don't know if it's going to catch on, but Colton Tucker's giving it a shot. So when you share on social, call it the 6. Just make sure you spell it right.
I saw it. I saw a no.
Okay, all right.
Well, I saw one.
He gave it a shot. So obviously, when it comes to something like the Mark of the Beast, there's like all kinds of different views on it, coming back to the end times people who get really jacked up about it. So back in the 80s, people, because of course the Mark of the Beast, for those of you who don't know, Revelation 13, there's literally one passage in the entire Bible that talks about it. Revelation 13 says there's a beast crawling out of the sea, and there's a number of the beast, and it's 666, and the name is the number of a person, and of course it's a code for a person. So all kinds of speculation. What is this, the Antichrist? Is it, in the 80s, people thought it was Ronald Reagan, because Ronald had 6 letters, his middle name had 6 letters, forget what it was, and his last name had 6 letters, so Ronald Reagan was the Antichrist. He was the Mark of the Beast. Of course, conservatives don't think that. They think he's the Christ himself or something. Like, conservatives really loved Ronald Reagan on the total flip side of it. But other people thought. So you have all these speculations. What's 666? And then when I was growing up in the 90s, it was like computers. Computers are the mark of the beast because it has 666. And then there was like, oh, and then there's going to be this thing that gets put on your right hand and your forehead. That's the other part of Revelation 13. And so we're all looking for the Neuralink, you know, from Elon Musk at this point. And we're like, if someone, the government says, I'm going to put a mark on your thing, then you're not going to be able to buy watermelons at the grocery store, so you better put this on. And we're all, we're not going to do that. That's the mark of the beast. Whee! Here's the problem. Here's the problem with thinking about it that way. I actually think the book of Revelation is far more, if that's what the mark of the beast is, then the book of Revelation is relevant to one small group of people at the end of time. But if I believe the book of Revelation is actually a book that's been relevant all through time, and it's a book laden with symbols that are trying to explain something to every disciple of every generation about what it means to follow Jesus in the midst of the empires of the world, and to follow the woman of chapter 12 versus the beast of chapter 13, what that means then is, if we're living out that right now, if all I'm doing is looking for a chip, like a literal chip on my right hand or my forehead, I might be missing the fact that I'm already following the ways of the beast right now, and I'm distracted looking for a literal chip. Because the way of the beast has always been that you're doing right hand and thinking the ways of the empire that you live in versus the empire of Jesus. So you are doing money the way the empire that you live in wants you to do it. And you're doing sex the way they want you to do it. And you're doing family the way they want you to do it. Instead of doing it the way of the lamb, you're living the way of the beast. That has everything to do with now. Forget just some plastic chip that's literally in your body. This is a way of life now. So, great question.
That's so good. I've never heard that before. That's really great.
I actually think it's a distraction if we take it down the other route, because it becomes irrelevant to us.
That's great.
And I think everything in the book is about that question. Whose allegiance do you give when you wake up in the morning? To the ways of the beast or the ways of the lamb?
That's great.
It's the question every day. It's the question you ask tomorrow. It's not just, oh, no chip in my hand. I'm good. It's like, no, you might already be following the ways of the world.
That's great.
And you're looking for the wrong thing.
Wow.
Anyway, so
this question made me laugh. It says, so the Bible says that the wages of sin is death.
You're going to start giving commentary on people's questions now. I mean, this person.
No, this is good.
You know, raise
the Bible
your hand
says
if it's you.
The wages of sin is death. So why in the sus is 1 John 5:17 talking about sin that doesn't lead to death then? Which, by the way, just for context, 1 John 5:17 says, all wrongdoing is sin, and there is sin that does not lead to death. And to translate, what in the sus means, why in the heck is 1 John 5:17? Am I right, kind of, young adults, in saying that?
What sus means, why
in
the sus?
That's what sus means? Okay.
Why in the sus?
Why in the sus?
That's great. I got to add that to my vocab.
Please don't.
Okay, I won't.
Not for you.
Not for
it's
me.
For them.
I'm generational?
Yeah, generational thing.
Probably the easiest answer. I mean, I don't have a deep answer on this other than oftentimes when you see a seeming contradiction, that's not even a contradiction, but if you do see a seeming contradiction, it's usually about context and style and what they're talking about. So I think the one they're referring to in Romans, Paul's talking about like the Adam story, and he's saying, you know, Adam sinned and that sin led to death, and we all sin and we die in Adam. And then John is doing a vastly different thing. It's amazing how the writers actually emphasize different things in different ways. And I think John is talking about, John's audience is a very specific problem that he's addressing. I think Paul's doing kind of a generic humanity thing in Romans. John is addressing a group of people who have false teachings in their church because of Gnosticism, which means they believe that there's a spirit world and a physical world. And the only thing, it's actually very interesting, Gnosticism in many ways is the sin of our culture. They believe all that matters is what's internal and what you feel. What the physical world is useless and gives you no hints to who you are. And so John was writing and he was trying to solve a whole bunch of problems that were leading to people just using their bodies however they wanted and not realizing that it's connected to their spiritual life. So where that verse falls in his argument trying to address Gnosticism, I'm not really sure. But I think Adam's doing more of a sin led to death in general. John's going, hey, not every sin you do, when you do it, you just die. Because that's what some of the people were arguing. If it was a sin, then it would kill you. And John's going, no. There's sin that doesn't lead to like death, like literally one-to-one. You were greedy and now, ergo, I didn't die so I can be greedy.
Yeah.
And John's like, no, that's not what he's talking about. Sin generally leads to the fact that we all die, but it doesn't mean every time you sin, you die.
Right. It's good. This one says, I understand the point about God loving us so much that he gives us a choice about whether to love him back or not. And certain choices can lead to hell. But I physically cannot imagine that God loves us enough to send people to hell for an eternity. Like, why doesn't he send them down there for like 10 years and then boom, zap them back up to heaven?
Those are some busy thumbs.
It's a good question.
Turns out our time is up, though. So, you know,
no, we
have to come back
left.
Next week. No, it's a very real question. And it's an honest question. I mean, I have a non-Christian family and a father who passed away when I was 15 that, to my knowledge, didn't know Jesus. So this is not a hypothetical question. The question of hell is not a hypothetical question. It's a very real one. So the first thing to say about it is Jesus is the one who introduced the concept of hell to the world. The Old Testament has a generic sense of death and judgment, and you go back to the dirt. It's not until, you know, loving Jesus comes on the scene that we hear about this doctrine of eternal punishment. And so it's very important that we kind of get it right in our head. And we're not going to understand the depths of it. I think the parts of it that we can understand are this. So when we think about hell, sometimes we think of it as like flames and, you know, people are literally being tortured to death. But that's, when fire is used in the Bible, it's like an image for, it's a metaphor for judgment. So it doesn't mean people are literally in flames. All the way through the Bible, it means judgment. That doesn't mean that it's not bad. It just means it's judgment, whatever that looks like. And the other thing about hell is not everybody's experience of it, I don't think, is going to be the same. So sometimes when we think about, like, well, there's Hitler and he did terrible things, and then there's, like, my Aunt Joanne. I don't know why I picked that name out of the air. And she went there, so... But you got to understand, every judgment passage in the New Testament doesn't just ask a question about your faith. It asks what you did with your life. And we're talking about a God. So John chapter 5, Romans chapter 2, Matthew chapter 25, Revelation 21 and 22. They all say, we open the books and we ask the question what you did. So I believe the judgment of God is going to be meted out perfectly. And if we're trusting that God knows more than us, and he's more loving than us, he is going to do exactly perfectly what that person actually deserves. And the thing about what they deserve is this. They spent their whole life not wanting, rejecting the sacrifice of Jesus, rejecting the person and the work of Jesus. Why would they want to be in heaven? Hell, C.S. Lewis and G.K. Chesterton said, is the ultimate appreciation of someone's choice. Lewis said the doors of hell, in a sense, at least before, are locked from the inside. There are people for their whole life said, I don't want the sacrifice of Christ applied to me. I don't want God to be part of my life. And so hell is this place where the free will of people was, okay, it's God saying, your will be done. You didn't want anything to do with me. So hell is the eternal expression of that choice. And the question of whether people would, you know, 10 minutes or 10 years of zapping, and there is a Catholic theology of that called purgatory, where people go there for a while and they pay for their sins. And the reason the Catholics came up with that is so that you would give them money. They needed these big cathedrals to build, and they needed you to worry about Aunt Joanne. So if you brought your money to the church and paid them a little money, Aunt Joanne might get out of purgatory a little sooner. That's how they built all those amazing things. That's what it was. And that's what, when you talk about Protestants, that's what Martin Luther and John Calvin and Zwingli were protesting against. So that's why we stream out as Protestants and Catholics remain, because they were protesting the abuses of the Catholic Church and trying to get people out of purgatory. And among other things. So all that to say, I don't know the answers to all the nuances about hell. I do know we all have a sense of justice in us. And even my family, who are hardcore skeptics against God, they would say, I like the concept of God judging child abusers and rapists and murderers. And so once you've got people who can agree to the fact that justice should be done for people that might not have even got it in this life, what Miroslav Volf says, the theologization of violence, that God gets to do it, ergo we don't have to, at least when you can agree to that, then hell is just this expression of that going on for eternity. So I don't know the answer to why it doesn't end after a period of time. It's just there's no biblical support for that idea.
It's great. Yeah. Rapid fire on this one.
Okay. Yes, I'll be quicker.
What is the... No, you've been doing
great. I saw your eyes glazing over at the hell question.
No, they didn't glaze over. I'm just saying, for time's
sake. Check the video later.
What is the biggest mistake the modern American Christian church is making, and if changed, would have the best impact for Christ?
That's a great question. That's tough. I think there's a few tensions in the political emphasis. You know, someone has once said, when you fuse politics and religion, all you get is politics. So I think if we could find a way not to be so political and remove the conversation about presidents and policies away from Jesus a little more, I think that'd be helpful, because then people who don't agree with your policies can still accept Jesus. And if they're like, well, to become a Christian means, like I was talking to someone the other day, and they said one of their hesitations is to become a Christian in their mind means they have to start voting this way and have a different view on these policies. And it's like, how did that get mixed up? I'm talking to you about Jesus. Why are you talking to me about some Supreme Court decision on something that's coming down the pike? We're talking about Jesus. So I think complicating, trying to untangle Jesus from politics, I think is one big thing we got to do. And then making sure that we're biblical people versus people who thrive off entertainment Christianity. There's a version of things of why we love being a Bible church, why we love preaching through books of the Bible verse by verse, is because here's what I want for your life. I don't want you to be dependent on me getting up here, stomping around with charisma, getting you all rallied up so that when a difficult thing happens in your life, you need to come back to the church, come in a room like this and get a hit just so you can get through the week. That's not good leadership. I want you to wake up when the storm hits and go, I'm going to go to the text. I'm going to go to the Word of God. I'm going to base my life. The steel in my spine is the theology of the sovereignty of God and the biblical scriptures. And I want to meet God in the Word versus meeting him by coming and hearing someone preach all the time. And the more that I just play to your entertainment dopamine in your brain, the more you get addicted to this. I'd rather you get addicted to, I want to meet, Karl Barth said there's the Word, and then there's the Word behind the Word. So this is the small W word, and then Jesus is the big W word that you're meeting through the scriptures. And I think the more we get everybody just entertain me, the weaker we're going to be, especially when the squeeze of persecution comes.
It's great.
Because you talk to people all around the world where the church is actually growing and has no political power. The Spirit of God is moving the fastest it's ever moved in the history of time right now in China. There's more people coming to Jesus in China. There's 3,000 people coming to Jesus per day in Latin America. More people coming to China, and Christianity is illegal, and they can't even have church. All they have are like random printouts and people writing scrolls of the Bible because they're like, this is my life and I'll die for this.
Yeah.
And I think if we did that, if we got you to like treasure this versus the experiential stuff, not the experiential stuff's bad. There's a Wesleyan quadrilateral. You can look it up later. And it's an epistemology. It talks about how we learn stuff and know stuff. And it says there's four quadrants of how we know things. Reason, tradition, experience, and scripture. And I just think scripture should be bigger. Sometimes we elevate experience over scripture, and that's where we get the very subjective experiences that we start to go, I think I'm going to believe this now, and we start rewriting the Bible itself.
Yeah.
Because of how we feel.
Yeah.
And I think that could be a dangerous road to go down. So.
That was a great answer. It was not rapid fire, but that was a great answer. That was awesome. Last question.
Oh, yeah, that was rapid fire. Politics.
This was last question, okay? But before we get to the last question, we have to tell you about a couple things coming up. And this is the last question we're going to do, so stick around for it, okay? First things first, if you are interested in attending our marriage conference, we want you to be there. You actually don't have to be married to attend the marriage conference. You can be wanting to be married in the future and attend, okay? Marriage conference coming up here.
Aren't you teaching the marriage conference? I mean, you have so much to offer us.
No, you are actually.
After 3 weeks, you're not teaching?
I know nothing about marriage.
I thought you were teaching a session.
No, we're hosting a room where you're teaching this session.
Oh, okay.
No, we're not experienced for that yet.
All right.
Also, Serve Day is coming up. Serving, unleashing compassion on our community.
Going to be awesome.
Huge value here at Bayside. So if you're not a part of it, you should be. To get more information on both of those things, go ahead and visit this table over here to my right. We'll have pastors there that will love to connect with you on that. And
love
then
it.
Also, 6 p.m. service is a time for community, and we are wanting to build up our young adults community. We have Cane's Chicken for you outside.
Woo!
I know, right after this. So stick around, okay? Those are the only three announcements. Last question.
Just
and we're
for
done.
Young adults?
Yes.
Just
sorry.
For young adults. So you have to prove that you're under 25.
Show us ID at the door.
All right.
Last question. And this one actually has to be rapid fire, okay? How do I know that I know that I know that I know Jesus?
Rapid fire on that. Okay. I don't know how to like know that I know that I know, but I would say the closest thing is there was a great theologian 500 years ago who said, you know, because we believe in justification by faith, right? Like if you have faith in Jesus Christ, you are justified before God. That's the Christian gospel. But he said, the main ingredient, and I'll just give my life for this message because I say it over and over. The main ingredient in saving faith is that you love him. Not just that you trust, not that you're just in a forensic relationship with God. Where you're like in the law court of, dang, and there's a judge and that's great. And so one writer has said, do you not only trust Jesus like this chair? I trust it. I sat on it. It's going to hold me. But do you, like, do you love the chair?
It's a weird moment.
So weird. But I'm doing it so that you remember.
Yeah.
I'm not much of a prop preacher, but I have one sitting here. So do you love the chair? Do you like hug the chair? Do you say, I want to actually like spend my life. All right, it's enough of the chair thing. So I really want you to not just trust God. I want you to love him. I want you to like burn with affection for God. And when you have that, when at the end of the day, when no one's looking and no one's evaluating your performance and the lights are off and you're totally alone, do you actually love him? Like treasure him, have affection. Because Dallas Willard said, you're going to go to heaven one day and be with Christ forever. But you might want to ask the question right now whether you're going to want to go spend eternity in the presence of someone that you didn't find all that interesting in this life. And I think if that's you, you put your finger on that and you start to work on it. Does that make sense?
That makes a ton of sense. Yeah. That's really good. We didn't get to all of your questions. That's okay. We'll get to them at some point. No, you did awesome. You did awesome. This was amazing. Did you enjoy this?
Okay.
Yeah, this is so good. And this is just the beginning. We're going to keep on doing this stuff for our 6 p.m. Sunday night services. We'll have guest teachers. We'll have Q&A. We'll have more extended worship. So if you like this, bring your friends back to it because we really hope that you do like it. And we hope that you make this your service. That's all we got.
We'll see you next week, guys. God bless y'all. Thanks for being here.